I'm trying to think. There was a guy. I'm trying to think of this guy in Iowa City. What was his name? I can't think. I just got to think of some guy. There's a guy. I think I'm the only guy ever fired from WSUI.
Oh. Not Menzer. Carl Menzer ran, founded and ran the station.
No, it wasn't him. It was like his. It was a.
Like the program director.
It wasn't, the program director was actually, or the early morning disc jockey was Jerry Roberts.
Oh,
remember
sure,
him?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
And Jerry and I got along pretty good, except I didn't show up a lot of times. What was the guy's name? That was a silver-haired guy.
I can't not John Sondrel.
No, he was an older guy. He's retired now,
okay,
for sure.
Right.
What was his name?
Game,
I'm trying to think. I got to think of this. I had it on the top of my, but we just never hit it off for some reason. I don't. Oh, well, that's not important. I was just
middle of the interview.
Yeah, what was his name? I can see him. Hugh Cordier.
Oh, Hugh, yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Hugh Cordier, yeah.
So he retired. Uh-huh. I think I was there 6 months and he retired. So, I mean, I wouldn't even have thought, Hugh. Got the sack from Hugh, huh?
Yeah, I think so. It just kind of like phased me out.
Chase you out the door. Okay. And you'll vary the tightness and whatnot, just whatever.
Do you want me to look at you then, Jeff? Or,
hanging here. So at what point, either growing up in Washington or going to the university, did you decide, okay, I want to do this broadcasting thing?
Well, guys, you are starting at the very beginning.
Yeah, well, we take a step back.
You're not going to believe this. Okay, I was born in Washington, Iowa. We grew up in Wapello, which is in the southeast part of the state, and we had a big Little League baseball program there. And the public address announcer was one of these guys that was kind of like Harry Carey, he struck him out and everything. And I thought, man, I'm really interested in that, So I would go up there and help him as a kid, between games and stuff. If I didn't have a game or something, I'd help the PA announcer. Well, if you know small towns, there's a lot of bars. The guy would leave between games and never come back. So I would just take over. And people would come up to me after the game and say, Ronnie, that's what everybody calls me, Ronnie, you got to do this. You'll be on network someday. And I'm going, hey, I do like radio. This is really a lot of fun. I used to listen to, the Silver Dollar Survey on WLS, the Big 89, every afternoon from 2 to 6. And my dad would get so mad because I'd wear the battery down in the car. The battery would be dead. My dad would go, Ronnie, get in here, But when I got to school, I really went to the University of Iowa to be a coach and a teacher. That was my main goal. I love sports. I love to work with people. And we had to live in the dorm that year in 327 Hillcrest. Bill Weaver and I, Bill Weaver runs the newspaper in Macon, Georgia now, the Hearst paper down there. And we were roommates, and I was looking on the quad bulletin board, and it said, wanted, radio disc jockey. Oh, that's all I needed. I ran over there, and a guy named Steve Scott was running the station back then. And I said, I want to do this really badly. He said, you have any experience? And I said, of course not. But he said, well, okay, that's good enough for us then. And it was a little 15-watt between the dormitory on the telephone line radio station, KICR back in those days, and it's developed into quite a great station in Iowa City now for the campus station. But that's where I got my start. And when I saw that thing, radio disc jockey, that's all I needed,
Let's see, I went to KWAD for quad, I think.
Exactly,
after
right,
and
yeah.
And
yeah.
RUI by the time I got there, and now you can actually hear it.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Going through town as opposed to me tomorrow about carrier current. So that's a good one. That's how it started, KWAR too. So obviously it was sports, and that led you to.
Yeah, I was really lucky enough when I was in school to work at almost all the Iowa City radio stations, KXIC, and the WSUI. I think I was maybe the only guy ever fired from WSUI for not showing up for work, and I was a rather irresponsible young man back then. And I worked for KCRG my sophomore year. I worked. My junior and senior year, I drove back and forth from Iowa City to Davenport working for the Palmer Station, the NBC station Channel 6 in Davenport, and actually worked there after I got out of school. My wife's from Waterloo. We were home one weekend, and her father-in-law said, hey, did you hear the sports director of Channel 7's leaving, Mike O'Connor? And my mind was going click, click, click. I rushed my tape down there, gave it to a guy named Jim Bradley, who was the general manager back then. Grant Price was the news director. I didn't hear from him for 3 months. And finally, Grant called me, in his deep voice, wanted to know if I wanted the job. I had to take a pay cut to come from Davenport to be the sports director at Channel 7 in Waterloo. But I was, I think, 24 years old then, and And that's what I wanted to do, and Grant was nice enough to hire me. You know, back in those days, like a lot of shops, we had AM, FM radio, and television all in the same newsroom. And I mean, under Grant Price, if it moved, we covered it. If it didn't move, we covered it. We covered everything possible in that community. And that's one of the things that we've kind of gotten away from today. We can't decide whether we're in the entertainment business or the news business, or I think the obvious answer is a combination of both. But those days were fun. I really miss having the combination of both radio and TV in the same newsroom. I really miss that. I love radio, although my voice is not exactly the... Tom Peterson was my predecessor as the anchorman. Now he's the news director of WGN Radio. He's got the great radio voice, you know.
And for some reason, it seemed to me, because I remember growing up watching Tom, and then, of course, then he went on, and did PR, and then went to Detroit, and
exactly,
then, and then to Chicago.
Yeah.
But just listening, the voice is even deeper. I mean, it just
it's unbelievable.
Now,
yeah.
Doing the radio.
He's a big smoker, of course, you know. In those days, you know, that's what they, and I never was.
Three packs a day, a lot.
Yeah, there you go, yeah.
Voice. Now, obviously, him leaving led you to be able to do something that was pretty much unprecedented.
Exactly. In fact, in those days, I was about ready to move on. We had one-man sports department, me, back in those days, and we did a lot of stuff. We did everybody wanted Iowa basketball. We decided to go with Dan Gable and the Hawkeye Wrestling Show. We did that every week. Some of it we did live telecasts, much like IPTV does now with the wrestling, or put it on tape as live, and we really had fun doing that. In fact, I was up pretty much in position to be the announcer at the Olympics in 1980, and then, of course, what happened was President Carter boycotted, we didn't go, and I was really disappointed because I was doing a lot of stuff for NBC Sports back in those days for the old grandstand program. I'd done wrestling finals for ESPN and done a lot of stuff for them and for CNN, and actually did the women's college basketball finals one year, the year that Delta State won their third year, their third straight championship. That was right before women's college basketball started its big push toward the popularity it enjoys today. I remember up in Williams Arena doing that final for NBC, and that was a big thrill, you know, and they didn't pay you much, but all you wanted to do was get the experience and hope that somebody saw your tape. And of course, in this business, lots of people see your tape or see you on satellite, and you get a chance to move pretty much anywhere in the country. Iowa, though, for me, is a tough place to leave because you have your family and your mom and dad and your grandpa and grandma and your brothers and sisters, and I never had that desire to leave, and that's one of the reasons I think why we've stayed, even though my wife said, we're only staying here 2 years, then we're going to Chicago or New York or whatever, you know.
And that was, what, 23
that
years
was
ago?
27 years ago, yeah.
So you came up here from Channel 6 and when?
I started April. In fact, I remember the day that I started here, April 1st, 1974, they were having a party here at KWWL. They had just become number one at 10 o'clock for the first time in the station's history, and we have been number one at 10 o'clock from that day forward to right now as we speak, yeah.
And you were on the sports side of it, what, seven years?
I worked sports until July of 1979 when Tom left, yeah. Tom turned it over to me in the middle of the newscast, and people always called up and said, I'm having a hard time not hearing you give the Yankee score, you know, and I don't hear that anymore. It took a while to get rid of that, though, because in those days, Brent Musburger had just made the change in Los Angeles, you know, from sports to news. It was a disaster. Bryant Gumbel had moved from sports to do the Today Show and things like that, so it was a risky gamble, but it worked out okay for our station, you know.
And, you know, I've noticed there have been a couple of times recently, I think it was Jeff was doing the sports and had a coughing attack, and then another time was just by design. You're doing the sports highlights. Is that?
Yeah, I'm trying to think what we were happy.
That a little bit.
I miss sports.
The guys were down in Arizona.
Yeah, they were doing. That's what I'm thinking. They were down at the bowl. Right. The guys were covering the Iowa State bowl game, and of course we're a little shorthanded once in a while, so I just kind of fill in and do the sports, and I miss it occasionally. Not very much, but like if Indiana comes to town or something, when Coach Knight was there, that was, you know, I kind of miss doing that. In fact, we started, Bill Bolster, who's now the president of CNBC, had a great idea. He said, let's do some Iowa basketball games. And Tony Powers and I from WHO, we were the original play-by-play guys on the three experimental games we did in the 1978 season. We covered a game at Indiana and two games at home, Purdue and Michigan, with Lou Olson as the head coach. We did pregame shows. We did those games with TK-76 cameras and the courtroom switchers that we would use covering a court case. So it was pretty archaic, but the ratings were astronomical. And the next year, of course, Bill continued that on, started the full-fledged Iowa television network. I moved to news. We brought in Oh My, Bob Hoag from our Sioux City station, and that was just an absolute phenomenon. It's still the highest-rated program ever in this market. And the ratings today are half what they used to be, and, you know, because there's a lot more diversion and stuff, but I mean, those ratings were just absolutely phenomenal. And Bill Bolster, of course, anything he touches in this business turns to gold. He's, you know, how he gets there may, you know, but he's a, what a guy. I mean, but he had a, when he came to me and said, we're going to do this, I said, this is a great idea. You know, I knew this was going to be a fantastic thing, and I had to make a decision then. Am I going to stick with play-by-play, or am I going to go to news? And I was really wanting to get into the news side, you know. So I in a way, I kind of missed not doing that. But then Bob Hogue is such a fantastic person. I really wish he was still working for us. He's now a state senator, believe it or not. He just got elected state senator in Hawaii. In fact, he called me for a campaign donation.
The question, what's Bob Hogue doing now? But
yeah.
Well, and that was a tough sell even too, because that's when Hill Street Blues was
exactly.
Big, and I mean that was
NBC probably wasn't real happy about us preempting things like that. I don't know all the background of that, but it was just such a phenomenal thing, because in those days there just weren't many basketball games on the air back then. That was really a real novelty for us to do that live, and it was fun. It was really fun, and the ratings, as I say, were just so astronomical. It was unbelievable. It used to even beat the Cosby Show, which was NBC's best show.
Everything. And again, we're talking about the time frame. You know, ESPN came on in, what, 79, 80, whatever mm-hmm. it was. So, I mean, this was all just new. What if you had decided, you know, I think I want to still do the play-by-play?
Mm,
Did you ever think about maybe going to work in Bristol, Connecticut?
That's exactly what I've told my kids. I said, you know, had the ESPN and all these other networks been around, I'm sure we wouldn't be living where we are today in Hudson, Iowa. And but there's a part of me that says I'm really glad we are living where we are today in Hudson, Iowa. Although I'm going to have a hard time keeping my kids in the state, probably. And that's the thing. I only have one that's going into journalism, luckily. The other two are going to get real jobs.
To support dad's old age.
Yeah, that's right.
Are they all three out of school now?
All three are in college. Two will be graduating this this May. In fact, the older one who graduates from Iowa in May, he's a six-year student. So his two-year younger sister will graduate a week before him, because Iowa State graduates a week ahead of Iowa. I've got all three. I have all three schools covered: Iowa, Iowa State, and UNI. Yes.
True Iowa.
Yeah.
Making the switch to news, you know, obviously, as you already mentioned, that was being done a few times, mm-hmm. but of course, not necessarily Gumbel, Yao, Musburger, certainly not. Could that be done today in this market, for example? Obviously, Channel 2 tried it a couple of times.
Pete Seifer is just a terrific person. He made the move from sports to news. I don't think Pete was ever appreciated by his own station. You know, I think he got, you know, he's a terrific person, great communicator, and did a great job. And but they've been struggling there a little bit. I don't know. It's hard to tell. I don't know what the research shows on that. We do, you know, we still do a lot of research to find out what people are thinking and what they like and what they don't like, and then try to figure out what we should give them that can keep us in business and yet fulfill our needs and our wants as broadcasters and journalists. You know, there's a part of me that says, this is what we really should be doing. Let's just lay it on the line. But we find that the people don't want to watch for a very long period of time. You know, we probably do more long-form stories than any station in the state. You know, going maybe not afraid to go a 5-minute or a 12-minute piece, whereas most stations are going 30 seconds to a minute 15 in this day and age, and that really bothers me, because it is really tough to be fair in a minute 15. It's really tough to cover the story in a minute 15, but it's really difficult to do it, and that's tough. The way the industry is going scares me a little bit. It really does, but it's kind of what the public demands and the public wants, and we're in a business that's scary, because broadcast stocks are not doing so well right now. We're a privately owned company, luckily, right now, and hopefully that'll stay that way for quite a while, as we can keep adding stations, buying digital equipment, new editors, and things like that. We wouldn't be able to do that on our own as just KWWL with local investors as the station started. You know, Grant, you know, and some other people have written about McElroy, how he used to walk the streets looking for people to invest $1,500 in this news television station, you know. And people laughed at him, but all those people, I believe, are millionaires now.
and Mac was not necessarily one to spend his own money on.
No, exactly.
Or
no,
either.
That's exactly. I mean, he was, you know, I did not know him. I really wish I would have had a chance to meet Mr. McElroy, the man I'd heard was such a tyrant and such a slave driver. I shouldn't use slave driver. That's a bad choice of words. Don't use that, please. I really wish I'd had a chance to meet Mac or Mr. McElroy that everyone talks about. You know, Mr. Buckmaster came up to me one time when I first started, and he showed me the ratings, and he said, Channel 2, WMT in those days, this is where they are. This is where we are, except for 10 o'clock. I said, we want to be on top. It's going to take a long time to do that. And he said, by the way, Mr. McElroy's trust is now over $40 million or something. That was a long time ago, too, so I hate to even imagine what it is now. But that was started from scratch with a guy with a dream. And, you know, there's a lot been written about how they got the license and the battle they had with KXEL radio, you know, to get that. And whomever won is the guys that are still in business, you know.
Well, and it's, you know, when I look back at the granting the licenses in Des Moines, you know, when you look at things like KSO and KIOA, they were big looking for TV stations. And if they wouldn't have landed, if they would have landed them, where would WHO be today?
Exactly.
They might be all right, but look at MKR and T.
Exactly. Well, you know, it's funny. Growing up as a kid, listening to, even in Wapello, Iowa, when I'd come to Des Moines, you know, you'd KIOA, Dick Youngs, you know, Jim Zabel. I mean, my hero from the time I started listening to ball games, you know. I mean, all the great people. I mean, when Russ Van Dyke retired at Channel 8, you know, everybody thought, oh, my gosh, that's an icon who's, you know, retiring. Even going back to Dick Petrick, the very first winner of the award, you know, from KOL. I mean, there's another great radio news station that, I mean, if something happened in Northeast Iowa, Dick's folks covered it. And same way with Grant Rice and our station. When it moved, we covered it. And I miss those days. I really do.
Is it an issue that attention spans are shorter, or we're trying to glitz it up a little more to match the primetime stuff, or is it just we're just different people now and it would never work?
Yeah, I guess I am one of those that thinks change is good. You know, the MTV format, I guess, or whatever you want to call it, of all the movement and stuff, that the networks have picked that up, even in the way they film their own primetime shows now. And it's just a different kind of way of doing things. I mean, if Hewlett-Packard and those folks had stayed the way they did, then, you know, Microsoft, you know, wouldn't be in business today. But they weren't interested in Microsoft stuff, so look what happened. You know, I mean, people have visions, people have dreams, and to do that, you have to make changes, and that's kind of what we're in right now. We're in this technological explosion that is just unbelievable. I mean, what we'll be able to do in the next 10 years, probably, what we're doing already. And it's amazing that a little station like ours can receive information from anywhere in the world, and with our uplink, we can send it anywhere in the world. We did that during the Gulf War in Saudi Arabia. And for me to be in Saudi Arabia doing a live telecast, interviewing the parents in New Hampton of a teacher we're interviewing in Saudi Arabia, that was pretty great for a station our size. I think we were pretty proud of that, and I'm really happy to be able to do things like that, even though we're in Iowa, considered to be a small population state where, you know, we don't get the kind of respect, I think, as journalists that we often deserve.
And being able to connect the parents with the child right there.
Exactly.
Through the satellite.
Unbelievable. I mean, that's, and you think, well, how do you do that? Well, I don't know how we do it, really, but I know one thing. We have the people that know how to do it, and that's, you know, I kind of front the thing. You know, I get a lot of the credit, but I don't deserve the credit. It's the people. We're a team. We've always been a team-oriented station here. We have dozens of people behind the scenes that get absolutely no face or name recognition. They're the ones, the nuts and bolts of everything that we've done in the 27 or 28 years that I've been around this market, and I'm really proud of them, and they really do a great job to make us, the on-air people, look good.
And that's through how many ownership changes?
Yeah, right. We did the local owners. We had the Aflac owners of 80. I thought they were really pretty good, you know. And they owned us for a while. They had a group of the seven stations, including the Sioux City station. And now Raycom, the new company, which is going to own, they want to own 50 stations, I think, in the next couple of years. You know, they are up to almost 40 now.
I want to ask about a few stories that you've done, essentially. We're also going to string a clip of what does winning the award mean, or what did it mean, once you were conscious enough to know that you won it. Just because we happen to be here, I want your best Grant Price story. I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but someday I'm going to need to know the best Grant Price story. But I don't want to be trite, Ron, and say, well, what's the best story you've ever covered? What's the one you want to be thought of? But obviously, covering the Gulf War, obviously Iowa's child, these things are important things. I mean, when you sit back, if you were to chronicle these things,
it's
what
funny.
Do you point to?
Well, you know, it's funny, when you can say you've interviewed politicians and presidents, and I have done that, and Bishop Desmond Tutu, and athletes and things like that, but it still comes down, believe it or not, to the person who is on the street, the average, everyday fellow Iowan, they're the ones from which we get all of our great stories. I mean that, I mean, I can tell you a story about an Iowa child or, for example, when we started Make-A-Wish here in Northeast Iowa, a young man called me from his, and this is on our website, I think, a young man called me from his hospital bed in Rochester, Minnesota, St. Mary's, and he called me up and said, Mr. Steele, you know, would you please come up here? I have cancer, I'm dying of cancer. I have to tell you about the trip that I took, you know. So I went up there, and Jeremy Lonergan was his name, a young man, 9 years old, and he was so excited. He had all these pictures of the trip that he took to Florida, sponsored by the national chapter of Make-A-Wish. There was no Northeast Iowa chapter in those days. And as a result of his story, we started a chapter here in this part of the state. This young man was so courageous, and I mean, his mother was there at his side all day long. And that story, to me, I can still think about that and almost start crying. I mean, he was a really brave young man who passed away shortly after we did the story a few weeks later. Those kinds of stories mean a lot more to me than even flying back on Air Force One and interviewing President Bush. You know, my daughter, it's kind of a funny story with that. I was working on it was a Saturday morning. I'm working on building a deck. I'm kind of a construction freak once in a while. I have accidents and stuff. But I'm working on a Saturday morning one time. I was right before the Bush-Clinton election, and Bush was in trouble, obviously. I've been trying to get an interview with the president all these months, you know, but they called from the White House, and my daughter answered the phone. She came out, and she says, Dad, the White House is on the line. And I'm going, yeah, right, Katie. She's always joking and things like that. She said, no, get in here. They want to talk to you. And so I went in, and sure enough, it was the White House. They said, if you can be in Albuquerque, New Mexico on Monday, President Bush coming back to Des Moines on Monday night, you can fly back on board the aircraft and interview him. And that was really fun. It really was. Pete Seifer and Bruce Audi and I went from Cedar Rapids stations, and we had a great time. And after the interviews were over, the president gave us a personal interview of the aircraft, and he was like a side of him that I'd never seen. If he'd have shown the side that he showed us during the election, he'd be president, would have been president for two terms. He was so relaxed. He was like a little kid. He was not being presidential. He wanted to show us the new shower that they had just put in Air Force One. And it was so funny. It was like he was like a little kid showing us around this place. But he was so natural. And he said, don't step on Jim Baker. He was sleeping there on the couch and stuff. And the most amazing part of that was all that equipment in the communications room of the Air Force One was built mainly by Iowans in Cedar Rapids, Rockwell Collins. And that was a thrill, too. Things like that. Probably the most fun story I've ever done, Grant wanted me to go to New York to cover the Heisman Trophy presentation. Chuck Long and Bo Jackson were in a battle, and Bo Jackson won it by the closest margin still in the history of the Heisman Trophy. But Grant asked me to go because the sports guys were all tied up. And I said, gosh, I think I could fit that into my schedule. And that was really, really fun. You know, little things like that are a lot of... Well, I mean, it's not a little thing, but it's just those kinds of stories come along once in a while. To be able to go to the conventions, to be able to interview certain people. The Olympics were a lot of fun, you know. I'm trying to interview, you know, David Robinson. I can't even reach him, you know. Shaq didn't want to interview us, but John Stockton, he's even shorter than I am. I really like him, you know. So.
Yeah, I'm remembering Bush's first campaign. Well, as vice president, so mm-hmm. It'd be, what, 80?
Yeah, right.
And he news conference Cedar Rapids, so I'm there, and he's just stiff as a board.
Oh, it's unbelievable,
podium.
Yeah.
And he came off the podium, and he's working his way to go out, and he just kind of leans on the rope line there, and it was at a hotel, and just starts chatting with the reporters, and so everybody kind of rushes over. You know, it's the same thing. It was just natural, normal, and again, if he'd shown
exactly,
that a little
yeah,
more.
Exactly, yeah.
Obviously, the circumstances under which you heard that you'd won this award were probably a little less than optimal.
Well, I was tricked. I had no idea. I think you called me, or my wife told me that you had called, or someone said they want you to do an introduction to Grant on presentation night for new scholarship that he's originating or something like that. And I'm going, oh, that'll be great. I'm kind of nervous. You know, what should I say about him and things like that? And I'm working on a house that I'm remodeling, and my wife was telling me, you know, we got to get going and stuff like that. And I'm going, I don't feel so good. You know, I've been having kidney stones over the years, and this one was a real bad one. And I ended up in the hospital that night, and she finally came in and told me that, well, they had tricked me, that actually I was going to win the Jack Shelley Award. And I mean, I was flabbergasted. I really was. That's a that's the highest honor I think you can win in broadcast journalism in Iowa, and I was really proud to be the recipient. I just only wish I could have been there. You know?
Well, you get a chance for the acceptance speech this year. But my phone went off about 2 that afternoon, and it was the whole because you were supposed to play in the band that night.
Right, exactly. That's another thing. I had to get out of playing in the band. Yeah.
And we were trying to withhold invoking the name Grant Price. You don't like to push that too much, you know. But Grant said, whatever it takes to get him there, fine, you can use me. And my phone went off about 2 o'clock, and Monty said, Ron's in the hospital. I said, okay, that's really funny, Monty.
Yeah, really?
And it wasn't, and my. Hmm. But obviously growing up, you would have heard Jack Shelley,
Yeah, do you know that I've never met Jack? Seriously.
Is that right?
I will meet him. I will have met him the day that this airs, or the day for the next presentation. And yes, but you know, growing up, you hear of him, you hear his voice, you know, you see him, but you wonder, you know, why in the world have I never met him? Of all the people I've interviewed, that's incredible, you know? It really is. I feel like just kind of walking into his class someday and say, you don't know me, but I won your award.
Well, the fact that he's still doing all this at age.
Yes.
Uh-huh. 90, yeah. I mean, it's just phenomenal.
Well, I think, you know, when you talk about people like Jack Shelley or Grant Price or Russ Van Dyke or any of the people we're referring to here, you just think of integrity. And that is basically what our business is about. Without the integrity, without the credibility that we have nothing. If people do not believe in what we do, we're not going to be in business very long. And those people started what we are doing today, and I'm sure that they're a little shaky about the way we're taking the business right now. I mean, I'm sure they are, but when you think of Jack and Grant and all the folks like that, Dick Petrick from KOL, it's integrity and hard work and starting at the bottom and not being afraid to go out and ask tough questions that people want to ask but are afraid to ask, and do it in a way that is sensitive, that it's not sensational, and that it has some meaning. And I've had people call me up after doing a very touchy story about a death or destruction, which we do on a daily basis, and they said, you know, Ron, I really didn't want to do this story, but you did treat us fairly. And that means a lot to me. That means everything, because you can do everything you can possibly do to be fair, and someone will see it as being unfair. But you have to look in the mirror and say, I did the best I could, I was as fair to all sides as I could, and that's the best you can do. And when someone calls you up and said, I wasn't happy about having to do the story, but at least you treated me fairly, then I think we've done our job right.
I always loved doing, when I was doing the political beat at WSUI, we'd do extensive pieces. And my favorite was one that, I don't even remember what it was that we did, but they got 2 calls in the front office. One who said we were too biased to the left, the other said we were too biased to the right as well.
There you go.
Frame
it, yeah.
Those messages. But,
exactly.
Now, Carol, of course, had remembered hearing him and had met him during things when I was teaching at Iowa State. But it didn't fully click until he received some honor and we played a tape.
Oh, wow. Yeah, exactly.
Broadcasts. And I'm looking at it. Her eyes just got real because she said, you know, now I remember on the
exactly.
farm in Conrad riding my tricycle around the dining room table, probably one of these big farmhouses, and remembering that voice. It just
even today, it's the voice even more than seeing you in person, I think. If I'm in a grocery store and I say something, someone inevitably will come around and say, I thought that was you, Tom, or Bob, or they may not get the name right, but it's the voice they remember. And it's the same thing with Jack Shelley and with Jim Zabel and all of the great voices that you listen to growing up as a kid. But it's the voice that people remember. You know, when they see me in public, what do they say? Ron, you're sure a lot shorter than I thought, you know?
That's the chair. And somebody once in Iowa City, I was in a grocery line, I was talking to somebody, and this woman just kept kind of working. And so I'm starting to write a check, and I swear she was over the top of her cart, because you're doing this, I should know who that is. Yeah. And I thought it was creeping me out a little until I kind of figured out, well, she obviously recognized my voice. You know, she fit the demographic of NPR, you know, so. I understand. I don't feel like it's a stalker, but. Well, let's see. What if someday we want to embarrass Grant at some function? What's a good Grant Price story that he will have to admit is true, but yet?
Well, I have used this many times, and he really gets angry at me. But when he was the news director at WMT, he gave the WMT scholarship, a very valuable piece of asset back in those days. He gave it to the wrong guy. You know, he gave it to a guy named Jerry Langheim, who well, okay, Jerry was a 4-point student, and I was maybe barely a 2-point student. But you know, I keep kidding Grant over the years about how he gave that scholarship to Jerry Langheim, and Jerry got out of the business after about 2 years, and here I am still struggling in this business, Grant, and you gave it to the wrong guy. But I'll tell you what, there is no person in this world for whom I would rather have worked all those years than Grant. I mean, he, if I'm anything at all, it's because of him. You know, I mean, he made you understand what hard work is all about not just going out and getting the story, but checking it and double checking it and being, number one, truthful, number two, factual, and I'm not necessarily in that order, but it had to be right. If it wasn't right, it was worthless. That's all there is to it. And he pounded that into us. And Grant, you know, if you've ever talked to him, sometimes on the phone, his phone mannerisms are not very good. He'll scream and yell at people and hang up on them. You wouldn't want him running your switchboard, let's put it that way. But he gets the meaning across, I'll tell you. When he sets you down to tell you something, he has your attention. There's no doubt about that.
I don't have that. And now Jim might have experienced that. Grant dressing you down a few times.
I believe Grant has mellowed, though, in the last few years, you know. And that's good, you know, that's good. But he was tough, but he was sure fun to work for, you know. There's no doubt about that.
Product showed.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say, finally, that 10, 15 years from now, somebody picks up this little compilation book or looks at a videotape or pulls this cassette out of the library. So what do you want them to think of when they think of you, your work? Something effective?
No.
Is that guy still going?
Yeah, really. No. Honestly, no one will really care, or a lot of people won't even remember down the road. But if they do remember, I want them to know and want them to remember when they think of me that that guy was fair. He was fair to everybody that he touched as far as doing a story. He may not have, been, how do I want to say this? Maybe he was over-aggressive on some occasions, but at least he was going after the truth. And the truth is a very difficult thing to find sometimes. I've had so many people just flat out look me right in the eye and lie, you know. And then that's why people wonder why journalists are a little skeptical. You know, we're skeptical because we've been lied to so many times, you know. I am one of those people, I'm naive enough to want to believe that all people are telling me the truth. But I know from experience that they're not. And it's our job to go out there and find out and double check things, facts, make sure they're right. And if people do remember me down the road, I want them, when they think of me, to think, hey, this guy cared about people. We cared about the kids that we had when I was a child. He was a good, solid journalist that was fair to people, and that the truth really mattered. That's what I wanted to remember. They're not going to remember, probably, but, you know, as long as my kids are proud of me and my wife is proud of me and the people are that I tried to serve over the years, if they were happy with my work, that's fine. That's all that really matters.
Well, should we hit the record button and do it for real then?
Okay.
Is there ever any doubt that you would go into journalism?
No, I kind of came through it by osmosis, Jeff.